In that case, yeah, in that case, أنلن كيئذن حروف الناصبة. Excellent. فجائية is إذا. Yeah, إذا فجائية. إذن would be different. So إذن, this is what we call, إذن. In that case, حرف ناصبة. لقام بنصري. Lam is تأكيد, and قام is فعل. And بنصري is جار. And نصري is مجرور. And مضاف مضاف إليه. Okay, so متعلق to the فعل. معشر is موصوف. خشن is صفة. صفة موصوف put together becomes the فاعل. عند is مضاف, is ظرف مضاف. الحفيظة is مضاف إليه. Okay, مضاف plus مضاف إليه. This becomes the ظرف متعلق to قام as well. Okay, so you have that. Now, إن ذو لوثة لانا. إن ذو لوثة, لوثة in two ways you can be read. إن ذو لوثة لانا. This is in. This is an interesting in. This is شرط in. This is شرط in. But the جزاء over here, what is the جزاء? So I need to keep that in mind. So in is شرط, ذو لوثة. This is مضاف مضاف إليه. Now, over here, the rule is this in Arabic. The rule is this. If you have harf shart, then you have to have, after the harf shart, you have to have a fi'l. If you don't have a fi'l after it, so let's say you don't mention the fi'l. Anyone know what that rule is? Like, let's say if I say, in Zayd ذهبa. I was supposed to say, in ذهبa Zayd. If you don't mention the fi'l after it, no, even if would be wa'in in wasliya. It has to have a waw before it. Hidden tell before it. We've been drinking. Damir mahzuf. Okay. This is in Nahu. If you want to read it up more, it's actually called Al-Idhmar ala sharitat al-tafsir. الإذمار على شريطة التفسير. The rule is this. If you have in زيد ذهب, in زيد ذهب, you have to assume hidden. Is that what you're talking about? You have to assume hidden the appropriate verb. So in this case, the appropriate verb would have been ذهب. In other words, you assume, إذمار means hidden, you assume a word which explains the word, which is explained by the word after the ism. So ذهب explains what word is hidden here, and we have to have a verb here because after in you can't have a shart, you can't have an ism after in, and this is quite common in the Quran. Yeah, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ. So if you read the tafsirs, what they'll say, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ, أي إِذَا كُوِّرَتِ الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ. Yeah, إِذَا كُوِّرَتْ. So over there, كُوِّرَتْ is hidden. And this form of sentence is actually more stronger than saying in ذهبa زيد. In زيد ذهبa is much stronger, much more emphatic than that. So let's go back to this. So he says in ذو لوثة لانا. If he had said in لانا, لانا is the verb that's hidden here. Yeah. In لانا ذو لوثة. It's more powerful to say in ذو لوثة لانا than to say in لانا ذو لوثة. If the ذو لوثة becomes soft. Okay, so that's a نحو point over there. Now the جزاء for in ذو لوثة لانا, there's amongst the grammarians, there's two major opinions that if you get a حرف شرط and you get the شرط after it, where's the جزاء? So one group of opinion is that the جزاء is mentioned before it. So if there's a full stop there and the sentence finishes, the جزاء is called a preceding جزاء, مقدم, جزاء مقدم, جزاء مقدم. This is the opinion of the Kufi scholars. The Kufi Nahwi grammarians say that the jaza, if the sentence stops and there's no jaza there, assume whatever came before as the jaza. However, the Basriyun, they say no. Sorry, mate, that don't work. They say the jaza always has to come after. And even if it doesn't come after, you have to assume it. Yeah, so muqaddar. Jaza muqaddar. Assumed. Hidden. Yeah, this is a hidden jaza. Okay, so that's al-nahu rule over there. And poetry is one of the main sources where grammarians get their rules from. Okay, so one of the main sources. Anyway, so in ذو لوثة لانا, we're going to stick to the Basri school because that's more safer. So it's a more safer school there is. So in ذو لوثة لانا, so in لانا ذو لوثة, what's hidden over here? Whatever came before. We repeat that again hidden. Just to keep the grammatic structure valid. Yeah, so the jaza would be there. So إذن لقام بنصر معشر خسن عند الحفيظة إن دلوثة لانا. Now, here what this translates as this. In that case, لقام بنصر معشر خسن. Very severe. خسن, خشنة, it means something that becomes coarse, very rugged. So معشر, the word معشر, according to Imam Khalil bin Ahmad, according to Imam Khalil, who is the teacher of Imam Sibawi, he says that Ma'shar is a group of people whose affair is one, and they have to be more than 10, in their tens. Yeah, so Ma'shar is a jama'atu min al-nas, amruhum wahid. Yeah, so a jama'ah whose affair is one, meaning their aim, their mission, their agenda is one. And it's called ma'ashar from the word ashara, because they have to be in their tens. Ma'ashar. Imam Khalil bin Ahmad mentioned this. Okay. So, khushun means like real, severe, hard, harsh, rough. So, a group of rush, a group of harsh men would stand up bi nasri in supporting me. When? Indal hafidhati. Does anyone know where the word hafidha comes from? And it's very important to understand how the Quran uses it as well. Anyone know where the word hafidha comes from? And you know what that means? Yeah, in Ramadan we know to preserve, very good. However, it has more of a deeper meaning. Yeah, preserve, protector. You see the word hafidha, the Arabs would originally use it for standing up for or preserving something out of honor and dignity. Yeah, so for example, let's say someone insults your family and you get really upset about that. Why do you get upset for? Because that thing that they insulted in your family was a hafidha. It was something which is considered to be appropriate for you to get angry about. So hafidha means, in this case, that an attribute, a quality inside of his tribe for which other people got angry about when it was desecrated or dishonored. So this is why hafiz in the Quran, hafizu ala salawati, ya hafizu, the word hafiz, it doesn't just mean to protect, it means to like really honor, and if something was to happen to it, you get really upset. Yeah, so hafizu ala salawat doesn't just mean, you know, be punctual with your salats. You need to honor your salat so much that if you were to miss a salat, if something was to happen to your salat time, that you'd get really emotional inside. Now you see, if you don't study poetry, you won't see how the context of that works. And you'll just stick to like a translation form of the word, which isn't really give the true meaning of it. So hafidha in Arabic, it means ma yughdab lahu. ما يغضب حمية. ما يغضب له حمية. Out of honor. Everyone understand that? Okay, so حفيظة. إن ذو لوثة لانا. Now, ذو إن ذو لوثة. The word ذو is أسماء ستة مكبرة. Yeah, you know, ذو, ذا, ذي, فو, فا, في, أخو, أخا, أخي. Okay, لوثة, there's two ways you could read this. You could read this لوثة. So, you could say لوثة with a فتحة. Or, you could say لوثة with a ضمة. So, what's the difference then? Yeah, so a change in the vowel can have a big difference. So, لوثة and لوثة with a فتحة. Yeah, لوثة and لوثة. Okay, so if this word has a ضمة on there, it means ضعف, weakness. Just by changing the vowel, if it has a ضمة, it means weakness. And لوثة with a فتحة, it means قوة, it means strength. Yeah, so with a فتحة, ذو لوثة, it means strength. The possessor of mighty strength. Yeah, and that's where the word laith comes from. Laith for lion. Yeah, laith. Like a really violent, powerful, strong animal. Lotha. And lutha, yeah, lutha with a dhamma, is the total opposite. So you see, in Arabic, just by a vowel changing, the whole word itself could mean something totally different. You've got to be very careful with vowels there. Okay. So we're going to come back to this. If it's Lutha, what does it refer to? If it's Lotha, what does it refer to? One thing I just want to mention here is this. Does anyone know the difference between if I said قام زيد بنصر علي or بنصر خالد and نصر زيد خالد. نصر زيد خالد. Which ones? Okay, what does Nasara Zaid Khalid mean? Yeah. Okay, depends on vowels. Zaid helped Khalid. And what does Qama Zaid bin Nasri Khalid mean? Qama Zaid bin Nasri Khalid. Zaid stood to help Khalid. So what's the difference then? Which one's more emphatic? The first one. Yeah, first one. Why? Because, see, Nasara Zaid Khalid means this. Let's say Zaid Khalid was getting beaten up in the road. And Zaid saw him getting beaten up and he quickly rushed. Yeah, and he went to help him. That's just called Nasara. He helped him. That's it. But Qama Zaid bin Nasri Khalid means this. It has more of a prolonging meaning. In other words, Zaid took lots of measures in helping Khalid. He stood up for him. He spoke out for him. He helped him. All those meanings and more come when you say Qama Zaid bin Nasri Khalid. So the author here, the poet, what he wants to say, إِذَنْ لَقَامَ بِنَصْرِ مَعْشَرٌ خُشُنٌ. He says that in that case, a group of mighty men, strong, rugged men, would have taken all measures to support me in the hafidati at the time when one of my rights was being, you know, those one of those issues for which a person can get angry was being dishonored. In dhuluthatin lana, yeah, if. Zuluthatin lana. So, in Zuluthatin lana, let's come to this now. So, if he says Zuluthatin lana, yeah, even if. So, over here, we can translate as even if. Or we can just say if. As in, that if the possessor of weakness becomes soft. Who is the possessor of weakness? his own tribe. Yeah, so Al-Ambar, he's talking about Ambar, his tribe. Bani Al-Ambar, yeah, when they go weak, Mazin doesn't go weak. Mazin, these people stand up against injustice. And if you take the meaning of Fatha, strength, then it refers to Mazin. In other words, in ذو لوثة لانا. Even if, normally, someone who is really mighty becomes soft, Mazin doesn't become soft. Yeah, like, you know, let's say there's a guy who's really strong. Yeah, and this guy, everyone's scared of him. But he's scared of a mouse, let's say. And we say that even when this guy